Hello everyone, I am Gyan and you are learning computer science with Python for class 11. In this video, we are going to learn about data types used in Python. In Python, we already have learned about variables and the value is stored in those variables. We know that we can create a variable like x is equal to 2, where x is the variable and 2 is the value, whose reference is stored in the variable x. When we press enter and type x, we got the value of x. We can also store some other type of data in the variable x. We can store x is equal to 2.3, and this is the fractional number. 2 was a whole number, whereas 2.3 is a fractional number. We can store x is equal to hello, and we know that anything enclosed between two double quotes or two single quotes is known as a string. So x is equal to hello is other type of data which we are going to store in the variable x. When we type x, we get hello. So there are various data types. There are various types of data available in Python which can be used for the programming. So in this video, we are going to learn about various data types used in Python. Data types in Python. Data types in Python. There are mainly 5 types of data used in Python. The first one is number. The second one is string. The third one is list. The fourth one is tuple. And the fifth one is dictionary. So there are 5 types of data used in Python. And we are going to learn all these data types one by one in this video. So let's start with number data type. There are 4 types of numbers supported by Python. First one is called integer. In fact, we have 2 types of integers supported by Python. The first one is called integers. Again integers. Don't worry if you are not getting it. I will explain everything one by one. So mostly supported integers by Python is called signed integer. The second type of integer supported by Python is called Boolean. Actually, Boolean is used for completely different purpose, but internally, a Boolean is also an integer. I will explain how it works. So, Booleans. Apart from integers, there are 2 more type of numbers supported by Python. The first one is called floating point numbers. Floating point numbers. And second one is called complex numbers. Complex numbers. So these are the 4 types of numbers supported by Python. Let's start with integer. Integers are whole numbers. For example, 256 is a whole number. 0 is also a whole number. 1323, this is also a whole number. So these are the whole numbers, etc. So numbers that have no fractional parts are called whole numbers. That have no fractional parts are called whole numbers. No fractional parts means no decimal point. That means 12.34, this is not a whole number. This is not an integer. Okay. Further, whole numbers can be positive or negative. Integers can be positive or negative. And if a symbol of positivity or negativity is not mentioned, that means that number is by default a positive number. For example, plus 2 is a positive number, minus 2 is a negative number. But if you do not mention anything before the number, then that will be considered as positive number. So hopefully you understand all these concepts. And as we have discussed, there are two types of integers. The first one is signed integers. Integers which is signed, and other one is booleans. So let's first see signed integers. What do you mean by signed? Signed means if a number can have both positive and negative value, then such number is called signed integer. Yes, computer allows us to store a number in a binary pattern so that we cannot treat them as a negative number. There is a provision of doing that. Means there is a provision given by the computer that we can store number in a given number of bits, and that number will not treat it as negative number. So such numbers are called unsigned integers. When you are not storing the signed information of a number, then such numbers are called unsigned integers. But Python only allows signed integers. So you don't worry about being signed or unsigned. This is a very in-depth concept which you may learn in your BTech course. But right now, don't worry about being signed or unsigned. For you, a signed integer means an integer can have both positive and negative value, then such integer is called signed integer. And if an integer is going to have only positive values, there is no provision to store a negative number, then such integer is called unsigned integer. Signed integer means you can store both positive as well as negative numbers in a variable. You can store both positive and negative numbers in a variable. The languages like C or Java actually tells about how many number of bits you are using to store a number. But here Python never tells you this. Python never tell anything about number of bits used to store an integer. Okay, you can just keep on storing your big or small number. It gets stored somewhere. The details of how a number is going to be stored by Python is not exposed by the language. Python never tells number of bits required to store a whole number. Now, whatever the examples we have seen, all are the examples of integer. Okay, 256, 1323, 0, all are the examples of integers. The second type of integer stored by Python is called Boolean. Actually, Boolean is not used to store an integer. Boolean is used to store the values like true value and false value. So Boolean represents, a Boolean represents true or false values. But how you are going to store true or false, and that you store as either 0 or 1. Here true means 1 and false means 0. That's why Boolean is taken as integer category. So true means 1 and false means 0. That's why Boolean is taken under integers category, because ultimately they are storing 1 and 0. If you want to take confirmation of how this 1 and 0 are treated as true and false, you can go to your Python cell and type int. In the bracket you write true. Press enter, int. Actually you need to write capital T, true. Press enter, and here you have 1. Capital T true means 1. It should not be small t. Okay, the T should be capital and other letters should be small. You can write here int, and then you can write false. press enter, and here it is 0. So true means 1 and false means 0. So this is all about integers. Now we are moving to other type of numbers supported by Python, and that is called floating point numbers. The other type of number is called floating point numbers. A number having fractional part is a floating point number. A number having fractional part is called floating point numbers. So a number having both integer part and fractional part. For example, 3.14159, where 3 is the integer part, and this portion after decimal point is called fractional part, and this one is called decimal point. Okay, so this is the fractional number. There are two ways to represent a fractional numbers. Notice here that I am not saying that there are two types of fractional numbers. I am just saying that there are two ways to represent a fractional number. Let's write it. Two ways to represent a fractional number. One is called fractional form. Example, your normal fractional numbers like 3.14 is a fractional form of representing a fractional number. So in the fractional form, you use normal decimal notation. You have a normal decimal point, you have integer part, you have a fractional part. Okay, normal decimal notation is used. Normal decimal notation is used. And other one is called exponent form. What do you mean by exponent form? It's representation of a fractional number in the scientific form is called exponent form. For example, 3.500 into 10 to the power 3. This is the exponent form of writing a number. But you cannot write 10 to the power 3 in computer. Okay, while using the computer, you cannot write this. So how you are going to write such a representation in computer? It can be like 3.500, then type capital E, and then you write 3. And this represents 3.500 into 10 to the power 3. Okay, other example is 0.5 into 10 to the power minus 4. So these are some representation of exponent form. Let's see some examples, some practical examples of fractional numbers. You can write x is equal to 2.4, and this is a perfect floating point number. And here we are representing the floating point number in fractional form. Now let's see a scientific form. X is equal to 0.5 e minus 4, and this is a perfect number. When you type x and press enter, and here you get 5 into 10 to the power minus 5. So as you know that 0.5 into 10 to the power minus 4 is same quantity as 5 into 10 to the power minus 5. Hopefully you know these things. These two are the same numbers. 0.5 into 10 to the power minus 4 is same as 5 into 10 to the power minus 5. These are the same numbers. So even if I have stored something like this, computer is showing me this one, which are same quantity. Now there are few advantages of using floating point numbers over integers. There are few advantages of using floating point numbers over integers. The first one is they can represent values between integers. What I mean here is between 1 and 2, you can have 1.5, you can have 1.6. Even between 1.5 and 1.6, you can have 1.56. Okay, so there are infinite numbers of numbers between any two integers. That means a floating point number is used to represent all those numbers which cannot be represented by integers. They can represent values between the integers. The second thing is that they can represent much greater range of values. That means after 1, there is not only 2. Between 1 and 2, we have infinite numbers of numbers. So we have much greater range of values than integers. They can represent much greater range of integers. But with the advantages, there comes certain disadvantages of floating point numbers over the integers. And the disadvantages, operations on floating point numbers are usually slower than integer operations. But operations on floating point numbers are usually slower than integers. And what can be the range of floating point numbers depends on which machine you are using your Python code. It completely depends on which machine you are executing your Python code. So Python never tells about range of integer or number of bits used to store the integers. Python never tells about number of bits used to store floating point numbers. You can store any number and that will be stored in Python variable. The another type of number we are going to study is called complex number. The another type of number supported by Python is called complex number. Complex number. I think you must have learned about complex number in your mathematics course. A complex number is a number which has two parts in it. One is called real part and other one is called imaginary part. You write complex number like this. 2 + 3j. 2 is called real part of the number and 3 is called imaginary part of the number. Whereas j is considered as root over minus 1. So this is called complex number. I am not going into details of complex number, but we will just see how you can write a complex number in Python. So let's go to our IDLE. And right here, x is equal to 2 + 3j. And this is a complex number. When you write x dot real, it prints real part of the complex number. And when you write x dot imaginary, means imag, x dot imaginary, it prints the imaginary part of the number. And when you type a variable name which contains the complex number, it prints complex number by putting it in a parenthesis. Now you have noticed that both real and imaginary parts of a complex number are actually fractional numbers. We have used integers here, but those integers are treated as fractional numbers by Python. So we can create a complex number like x is equal to 1.5 + 2.7j. And that will be your complex number, where both real and imaginary parts are fractional numbers. But as I told you, Python never tells about range of any data type. It never tells about range of integers. It never tells about range of floating point numbers. And it never tells about the range of complex numbers, because complex numbers are also created by using floating point numbers. Complex numbers, real and imaginary parts, are actually floating point numbers only. After number, we have another data type supported by Python. It's called string. String. Of course, we are going to have a complete study of string in the later videos. But right now, let's have a small study, a small length study of string. As you know that anything enclosed between double quote or anything enclosed between single quote are known as string. So ABCD is a string, and this guy is also a string. This one is also a string. Okay, anything enclosed between double quote or anything enclosed between single quote is called a string. But what a string actually is? Strings are sequence of characters. Strings are sequence of characters. Sequence of characters enclosed between double quotes or single quotes. Now suppose that I have a string S is equal to ABCD 1, 2, 3, 4. Or let's write it, S is equal to Python. Press enter. This is my string. Press enter. And this is my string. S is equal to Python. Now this string has 6 characters. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. The string has 6 characters. Each character, each individual character of the string can be accessed by using its index. So suppose that our string is S is equal to Python. Each individual character of this string can be accessed by using its index. So a Python can be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, P, Y, T, H, O, N, and each of these characters will have a separate index. And there are two types of index supported by Python. One from left to right, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and other one from right to left, means minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, minus 4, minus 5, and minus 6. That means the index from left to right should start with 0 and go up to 5. And index from right to left should start with minus 1 and go up to minus 6. These characters in a string are called individual elements of the string. And there are two-way index for every location of the string. One from left to right and other from right to left. The index from left to right starts with 0, whereas the index from right to left starts with minus 1. So there are two index for every location. You can assume that every character of a string are individual elements of that string, which are stored in individual locations, which are stored in separate contiguous locations. So all the elements of the string, all the individual characters of the strings are stored in contiguous separate locations, one after another. So when you write S followed by opening and closing square bracket, and in between you write 2, you get T as the output, because T is at the index number 2. Whereas if you write S minus 4 in between the opening and closing square bracket, you again get T, because T is at the index minus 4. Let's try it practically. You can write S 2 and it results T. In the same way, if you write S minus 4, it results T again. Now suppose that you are given with a string whose length you don't know. Okay, and of course you are not willing to count how many characters it has. You don't want to count like this, 1, 2, 3. You don't want to count like this. You don't want to count manually. So what you need to do is just type len. After the len, give a opening and closing parenthesis, means opening and closing a small bracket, and write the variable name whose in which the string is stored, and press enter, and here you got 6. The length of the string is 6. Now tell me, if the length of the string is 6, what is the maximum index here? The maximum index is 5. So length of the string is 6, whereas maximum index is 5. So If someone says you that find the last element of the string, then there are two ways of doing it. The first one is you can write s in between this square bracket, you write len s minus 1, and this will give you the last element of the string. And other way of doing it is s minus 1. This will also give you last element of the string. So let's try these two. S len s minus 1 and press enter, and it gives you n, and then you type s minus 1, it again gives you n. Now strings are immutable. What do I mean by immutable is, if s is Python, if s is pointing to Python, it's perfect that you can change s is equal to 2. It will start pointing somewhere else. Okay. So whole content, so the content of s has been changed. First it was pointing to Python and now it is pointing to 2. But content of Python itself cannot be changed. What I mean here is you can change s is equal to 2. Initially s was pointing to Python, but as soon as you change s is equal to 2, it started pointing to somewhere else. And this pointer was disconnected. But this is allowed in Python. But suppose that what do you want to do is you want to change s0 from p to q. And this is not allowed. One character of a string cannot be changed. Okay. A variable can start pointing to one string to somewhere else, that's allowed. But one character cannot be changed. A character of a string cannot be changed. This is how we say that strings are immutable in nature. So strings are immutable in nature. Mutable in nature. Let's try it. Let me try to change s1 from y to z. You want to change s1 from y to z. It should be equal to. Now press enter. And here you got an error. String objects does not support item assignment. You cannot assign a single item in a string object. You cannot change a single item in the string object. Okay, of course, s is pointing to Python, and you can change the whole s to point somewhere else. You can change p, z, y, t, h, o, n. You can do it. Now the s started to point at completely different location, but this string was not changed by our statement. So apart from numbers and strings, other type of data supported by Python is called list. The other type of data supported by Python is called list. A list in Python represents list of comma separated values of any data type. I will explain you the meaning of this thing. Between square brackets. Example, x is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So these are the comma separated values in between the square brackets. This is the list. The another example of list is x is equal to 1, a, 3.4, hello. So this is also a list. It's comma separated values of any data type. You can have any data type in a given list. Here we have four data types included in the given list. But all those types should be comma separated. So let's try it practically. X is equal to, I'm going to create a list, x is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4. And this is the list we have. If you type x, it prints 1, 2, 3, 4. The indexing is same as the string. What do I mean here is that in this x, I'm talking about this x, or let me give a different name, otherwise you may get confused. Give it a different name. Just name it y. Y is equal to something. So y 0 will be 1. Okay. Y 2 will be 3.4. So this is how, just like a string, we can also access a list by using its indexing. And just like a string, you can have two ways indexing for the lists. Means if I write y is equal to 1 a 3.4 hello, and if you assign them different indexes, then these indexes can go from, if you talk about left to right, the indexes will go from 0, 1, 2, 3. And if you talk about indexes from right to left, it will go like minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, and minus 4. So let's try it. If I type x1, it is going to print 2. And if I type x minus 1, it is going to print 4. Okay. And similar to string, if you type len and variable name x, you are going to get the length of the list. Okay. Similarly, if you want to access the last element of the list, you can write like x len x minus 1. This is going to give you the last element of the list. And when you write x minus 4, this is going to give you the last element of the list. But there is one important difference between string and list, is that lists are mutable. Means we can change one element of the list. Okay, what do we mean here is that x1 can be assigned as hello, and it will work. Now the second element of x is hello, so it works. That's why we can say that lists are mutable. Okay, strings were immutable, whereas lists are mutable, because one element, a particular single element of the list, can be changed. Let me write this statement. Lists are mutable. We can change just one element of the list. Okay. Now let's see another data type supported by Python, and that is called tuple. After list, you have something called tuples. See, tuples are same as list. Only difference is that, unlike lists, tuples are immutable. Means we cannot change one element of a tuple. Okay, if you want to create a tuple, you just need to write x is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, means comma separated values in between opening and closing small brackets. Okay, not a square brackets. So if you write list in closing in small brackets, that is called tuples. And only difference between list and tuples are non-mutable. That means tuples are immutable. Let's try tuples practically. Let's write here x is equal to 1 comma hello comma 3 comma 4, press enter, and this is your tuple. Now you can access them just like list. X2 will give you 3, x minus 2 will also give you 3, and because one index goes from left to right, 0, 1, 2, 3, one index goes from right to left, minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, minus 4. So 3 ends up on two indexes, 2 and minus 2. If you try to change an element of x, try to change like this, x1 is equal to, if you try to assign something else here, let me assign 8.9 at first index of the tuple x, this will throw an error saying that tuple objects not supported item assignment. The error was shown just like a string. We cannot assign an item, we cannot assign an individual item to a tuple object. Apart from tuple, we have another data type called set. After tuples, we have something called sets. Sets. So hopefully you know what is a set in mathematics. The concept of set in Python is same as the concept of set in mathematics. Sets are unordered collection of different objects. Okay, means there is no indexing in set. There is no indexing in the set, and duplicate entries are not allowed. If you have to write set, then you just write comma separated values between opening and closing curly brackets. What do we mean here is you can write s is equal to curly bracket 1 comma 2 comma 3 comma 4. And of course, in the set, all the elements can be of any data type. It's not like you are only going to give integers here. It can be any data type. But there are two differences between set and list tuple or string is that you cannot access individual elements by using its index because a set is unordered collection. There is no ordering. No ordering means we have not assigned any index to any element. We are not giving any number to any element. There is no ordering. We are not expecting the numbers to appear at the given index. Okay, that's why when you try to access an element by using an index, it will throw an error. So let's try to create a set and try some experiments. Let's create a set. S is equal to opening and closing curly bracket, in between you write 1, 2, 3 and 4 and press enter. Here is your set. If you want to see if this data type is set or not, there is a provision which can be used with any data type. You just type here type, type type, and then type the variable name. It will show the type of the variable. The type of the variable S is set. Okay, similarly, if you write S1 is equal to hello, then type of the variable S1 will be string. So the type function says you about the type of the variable, if it is set or if it is string or whatever. Now let's try to access individual element of the set, and you will not able to access it. S1 is equal to, when I tried to access individual element of a set, I got error that set object is not subscriptable. Okay, because elements of the set are unordered. Now let's try to create a set in which we have repeated elements like 1, 2, 3, 4 and 4. So 4 has been repeated twice. Of course, this is not going to show an error, but when you type, the set will have only 4 elements. Only one occurrence of the repeated elements will contained by the set. Sets are mutable in nature. That means we can remove an element from the set and we can add another element in the set. So sets are mutable in nature. Sets are mutable in nature. We can add an element to the existing set and we can remove elements from the existing set. See, we are going to have a different session, a different dedicated sessions on string, list, tuple, sets or dictionary. Okay, so here we are just getting a small introduction about these data types. When we have a dedicated session on sets, there we will learn how to add an element to the existing set or how to remove elements from an existing set. So this is all about the set for this moment, for this video. The other data type supported by the Python is called dictionary. See, dictionary is a set Dictionary is a set whose every element is a key value pair. Okay, dictionary is a set whose every element is a key value pair. And how we write key value pair is key colon value, like this, key colon value. Let's see an example of dictionary. Example. Of course, as I told you, dictionary is a set, so dictionaries should also be enclosed in between curly brackets, where each element is a key value pair. Here, A is the key and 1 is the value. This is one element of this dictionary. Then give a comma and type E colon 2. Then give a comma and type I colon 3. Give a comma and type O colon 4. U colon 5. So all these elements are individual elements separated by comma. E1, E2, E3, E4, E5. All these elements are individual elements separated by comma. And each element has a nature of key value pair. Okay. And of course, just like lists, these elements are not ordered, or we cannot access a single element by using the index. How we can use the dictionary is as if, as an index of the variable x, if you pass A, then it will result in 1. So if you pass key as the index, it will result in value. And this is what it happens. If you try to access x0, then since there is no key exist at 0, therefore it will throw an error. Since there is no key exist at 0, therefore it will throw an error. So don't try to access one element of a dictionary by using its index. Unlike set, it will not say that subscripting is not allowed, but at the same time, if there is no key exist with whatever you have written in between opening and closing a square bracket, it will throw an error. Now let's try dictionary. X is equal to, you can write any data type as key and any data type as value. Here I am writing 1 as the key and apple as the value. Okay, then giving a comma, and I am writing ball as a key and true as a value. You can have any data type as key and any data type as value. Then I am writing u as the key and 2.9 as the value. Press enter, and this is my dictionary. If I write here type, you want to find the type x. It says the type of variable x is dictionary, dict. See, you can write key as the index of variable. I am writing ball as the index of variable, and I got true, which is the value. I can write 1 as the index of variable, since for the key 1, the value is apple. Here I will get apple as the output. But if I try 0, since there is not any key in the dictionary which is 0, therefore here Python will throw an error. That key error, we do not find any key at 0. Okay, it is not going to say you that subscripting is not allowed. It will just say that the key you are writing here is not present in the dictionary. Okay, that's why for 1 it did not throw any error, but for 0 it is saying that we do not have any key which is 0. We are going to learn about all these data types in the separate sessions, in the separate videos. See, string, list and tuples, and dictionary. These four data types are called iterables. Number and sets are not iterables. Now, what do you mean by iterable? Iterable means a data type in which a single element can be accessed one after another. Such data types are called iterables. Sets are not iterables because we cannot index them. But as you know, dictionaries can be indexed by using their key values. So dictionary is iterable. We will learn more about iterables in the coming videos. At last, there is one more data type supported by Python that is called none. None means nothing. When you have nothing to store in a variable, you store there none. Like you can write x is equal to none. Means there is nothing in it. So let's try nothing practically. Let's try this none practically. Let's write here x is equal to none. See, the first n should be capital in none, otherwise it will not be a data type. So first n should be capital. Press enter, type x, it prints nothing because x has none. Print and then type x, it's printing none. Okay, so none means nothing. When you have nothing to store, you just store none there. We are going to learn more about none in the coming videos. This was just an introductory video on data types supported by Python. At last, let's revise all these data types in Python. So we have core data types in Python. In core data types, we have something called numbers. In the numbers, we have integers. After integers, we have floating point. Floating point. After floating point, we have something called complex numbers. Complex numbers. There is one more type of integer which can store only 0 or 1, and that is called boolean, which is mainly used to store true and false. Apart from numbers, we have something called set. Then we have something called none. Then we have something called sequence. Sequence means string, tuple, and list. These are the sequence. After that, we have something called mapping. Mapping means the map between key value pair. Mapping. And one data type under this category, under the mapping category, is called dictionary. Mapping means when you have mapping, means key is mapped to value. This is called mapping. So only data type supports mapping is called dictionary. So hopefully you have enjoyed this video. In the next video, we will learn about mutable and immutable data types in Python.